Well, good morning, everybody. If y'all would stand up and let's worship together.
We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He.
And together we sing.
Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory.
The earth is filled with His glory. Church family, it is good to see you this morning. Hey, if you are a guest with us this morning, be sure that you have one of our bulletins. You can tear out one of the little info cards here, put it in the offering plate. That way we can get to know you, we can reach out to you, we can pray for you if you have a prayer need. We would just love to build relationships with you and get to know you and hopefully let you be a part of our church family here at Myrtle Grove. So that being said, there's a whole lot more announcements in there, and we'll get to some of those later on in our service. But it is good to see y'all this morning. Let's pray real quick, and we'll continue worshiping the Lord. God, we love you, and we praise you, and we thank you so much, God, for just another beautiful day to wake up and come worship you in your house. God, I pray this morning that you will move in our hearts and our minds, God. Speak through worship. Speak through Brother Josh's sermon this morning. God, you know the words that you have for him. And God, I pray that as we sit here this morning and we just think about all the good that you have poured out over us, God. God, that we don't take those moments for granted, and that we don't take church family for granted. We don't take church worship for granted. God, we worship you with our full hearts, minds, body, and soul. God, we love you. We praise you in your heavenly name. Amen.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. The only one who could ever see.
Isn't that a sweet song? Trusting in Jesus. That's where we need to put our trust. I'm Johnny Jernigan with the Deacon Yoke Fellers, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we just come to you this morning, thanking you for so many, but thanking you so much for our salvation, your sacrifice that you made so we could have salvation. Let us just give you praise and glory for that. And God, just let us seek you in everything that we do. Be with the people in Ukraine and Russia. Lord, just be with the whole world. Lord, we seem to be headed in the wrong direction. Just be with us, lead us, and guide us. And God, we just pray for those people over there that is getting bombed every day. We just lift them up to you and ask God that you'll be with them. And God, be with our church here as we spread your word in this neighborhood and around the world, Lord. Just be with us as we trust in you and bless these offering and tithes that we're about to take to further your word in this world. And we ask these things in your holy, precious name.
Faithful he was to the children of Israel to lead them. The ark carried the children of Israel to the southern border of Canaan. And then the 12 spies came back with a report of the land. And they said, it's a good land. It's a great land. And it's flowing with milk and honey, just like the Lord said. And look, here's a cluster of these grapes, and it's so big that we had to carry it on the pole between two men. But we can't go in. See, there's giants in the land. Well, for doubting God and that blatant disobedience that the 10 of the 12 spies brought back a bad report, God gave that generation a death sentence. He told them that they would die in the wilderness, but their children would inherit the land. Well, in Numbers 14, the Bible says in verse 39, when Moses told these words to all the people of Israel, the people mourned greatly. And they rose early in the morning and they went up to the heights of the hill country saying, here we are, we will go up to the place that the Lord has promised, for we have sinned. But it was too late at that point. And Moses said, why now are you transgressing the command of the Lord when that will not succeed? Do not go up, for the Lord is not among you, lest you be struck down before your enemies. For there the Amalekites and the Canaanites are facing you, and you shall fall by the sword. Notice he says, the Amalekites and the Canaanites are facing you, not facing God. They're facing you, and you're going to fall. Because you have turned back from following the Lord will not be with you. verse 44 of Numbers 14, Moses said, Moses writes, "But they presumed to go up to the heights of the hill country, although neither the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord nor Moses departed out of the camp." God stayed where he was, and the children of Israel tried to go up. Verse 45 says, "Then the Amalekites and the Canaanites who lived in that hill country came down and defeated them and pursued them even to Hormah, ran them out of the land because they presumed to go up without God." Now fast forward 40 years, and the previous generation buried in the wilderness. Now God begins showing the Israelites His power through military victory. Now these are the children of those who came out of Egypt. And He begins to defeat the kings of Arad and Midian and Moab that are outside of the land of Israel, showing those children that are now adults the power of God and what He can do. He's teaching them to trust. The question is, would they trust God to lead them all the way up into the promised land, or would they, like their parents, come to the brink of the Jordan River and doubt God? You know, there's a lot of scripture about doubting God, and biblically speaking, when we doubt God, what we're saying is that we don't believe what God has said. We don't trust what God has said. That's what doubt is. It doesn't mean that we don't have the answers and we don't know. Because there's several people in the Bible. I'll point you to Mary, the mother of Jesus, as an example. When Gabriel told her she was going to have a child, she said, "How can this be? I don't understand." She didn't say, "God, I don't believe you. I don't believe what you said is true. I don't think you can do it." She said, "How is that going to happen?" There's a difference there. But biblically speaking, we're told not to doubt. I want to give you these scriptures. We're going to run them off real fast, rapid fire, okay? This is real quick, so be ready. Listen fast. If you want to take notes, you can write them down. I've got the references on the screen for you. Scriptures about doubt. Matthew 14, verse 31, Jesus immediately reached out His hand and took hold of him, saying to him, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" Matthew 21, verse 21, "And Jesus answered them, 'Truly I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what has been done to the fig tree, but even if you say to this mountain, be taken up and be thrown into the sea, it will happen.'" Mark 11, verse 23, "Truly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, 'Be taken up and be thrown into the sea,' and does not doubt in his heart, but believes what he says will come to pass, it will be done for him." Luke 24 and verse 38, "And he said to them, 'Why are you troubled, and why do doubts arise in your hearts?'" John 20 and verse 27, "Then he said to Thomas, 'Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Stop doubting and believe.'" James writes, "But let the person who asks of God for wisdom," prays for wisdom, "ask in faith with no doubting. For the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind." The Bible over and over again teaches us that we should never doubt who our God is and what He can do. And so this truth, and this is what the children of Israel learned on the bank of the Jordan River, if our God goes before us, nothing can stop us. I want you to hear that again. I want you to let it press into your heart. If our God goes before us, nothing can stop us. There is no pandemic that can stop us. There's no threat of war that can stop us. There's absolutely no financial problem that can stop us. There's no gas pump with $5 gas prices that can stop us. If our God goes before us, nothing can stop us. So let's stand together and let's read from Joshua chapter 3. By the way, did I tell you that's where we're going to be this morning? Joshua chapter 3. And we're going to pick up in verse 14 as we read together. The words are on the screen there for you. "So when the people set out from their tents to pass over the Jordan, with the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant before the people. And as soon as those bearing the Ark had come as far as the Jordan, and the feet of the priests bearing the Ark were dipped in the brink of the water. Now the Jordan overflows all its banks throughout the time of the harvest. The waters coming down from above stood and rose up in a heap very far away at Adam, the city that is beside Zarethan. And those flowing downward toward the Sea of the Arabah, the Salt Sea, were completely cut off. And the people passed over opposite of Jericho. Now the priest bearing the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stood firmly on dry ground in the midst of the Jordan. And all Israel was passing over on dry ground until all the nation finished passing over the Jordan. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we know what you did back then, you can do again. And Lord, we know that you are a God of miracles. You're a God of mercy. And you're a God that loves your children. And you're making a way for us, even today. God, I know that there's some today that came in with burdens on their heart. Lord, you're the lifter of burdens and you're the lifter of our heads. And God, there's some that came in today and they're facing questions that they don't know how to answer. But God, you are the God who answers all of our questions in Christ Jesus. And Father, there are some that came today facing a mountain that needs to be moved. Lord, you're the God that moves mountains. Father, I pray that today you would renew our faith in you. We wouldn't doubt for a moment who you are and what you can do. Lord, that we will go forward with you, knowing that if you are with us, nothing can stop us. Father, there's going to be a day when you will return. And in that moment, our faith will become sight. And Lord, we will in that moment wonder why we ever doubted you. Today I pray that the heart that needs to be strengthened, Lord, we find its strength, its rest, its encouragement from your word today. Speak now to us. Help us be ready to hear and receive. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. I want you to see four truths about God and his nature that the children of Israel learned as they crossed over the Jordan River following the Ark of the Covenant of God. So back up with me and let's look in chapter 3 and look at verses 1 through 6. Then Joshua rose early in the morning and they set out from Shittim and they came to the Jordan, he and all the people of Israel, and lodged there before they passed over. And so you get the picture. They've camped at the Jordan River. And they're going to stay there 3 days as they're looking at that water rushing past. And then it says, at the end of 3 days, the officers went through the camp and commanded the people, as soon as you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God being carried by the Levitical priests, then you shall set out from your place and follow it. Yet there shall be a distance between you and it, about 2,000 cubits in length. Do not come near it, in order that you may know the way you shall go, for you have not passed this way before. Then Joshua said to the people, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. And Joshua said to the priests, take up the Ark of the Covenant and pass on before the people. So they took up the Ark of the Covenant and went before the people. God, our God, is unequaled. He's absolutely unequaled on the earth, in all of the universe, in all of heaven. God is unequaled. God promised in that moment that he would do miracles among them. Why did they need to see a miracle? Let me tell you why they needed to see a miracle, why they needed God to show up. This generation came out of Egypt, They died in the wilderness, but the next generation, this generation that we're thinking about today, never saw all the miracles of Egypt. If they did, they were little children, little babies. They don't remember it. They never saw the Red Sea part. They weren't privileged to all of those things. And now they need to see it again. And they've heard rumors about the God of the Canaanites and the God of the Amorites, the God of the people that live in that land that they're about to go up against. Baal, the Canaanite god, was believed to be the king of the gods because he had triumphed over the god of the sea. Our God, Yahweh, intended that day to settle the score, settle the dispute once and for all in the hearts of the Israelites. Listen to what he tells them in Deuteronomy chapter 11. He says, every place on which the sole of your foot treads shall be yours. Your territory shall be from the wilderness to the Lebanon and from the river to the river Euphrates to the wilderness, to the western sea. No one shall be able to stand against you. The Lord your God will lay the fear of you and the dread of you on all the land that you shall tread as he did what? As he promised. Nothing can break God's promise. Whatever he says will come to pass. The gods of the Canaanites were nobodies. And God had already proven that the God of the Egyptians, the Egyptian gods, they were nobodies. And as we see God moving forward into the land of Canaan, he's constantly proving that these false gods are absolutely nobodies. And today, you and I, we need to realize that the gods that we serve here in America, the gods that our culture serves and bows down to and worships, those gods are nothing. They're empty. They can do nothing for us. People trust in the stock market and in money, but the stock market is a false god and it's a nobody. People trust in the government, but the government is a false god and it's nobody. People trust in the will of the universe, but the universe, the worship of the universe, that's idolatry. And it amounts to nothing. People trust in even in their family. Listen, if you put family first before your relationship with God, you're worshiping an idol, and that idol will let you down. People put their trust in the diet plan, or an exercise program. But it's, if you know diet is die with a T. The enemy has been sowing seeds of doubt from the beginning about who God is and about his power. Listen, Eve doubted that God wanted what was best for her. Moses doubted that God could use him. Elijah doubted the calling of God on his life. Peter took his eyes off of God, off of Jesus, and he started to sink. And Thomas doubted the power of God to raise Jesus from the dead. And we've been doubting ever since. But Mark Twain said, when in doubt, tell the truth. So I want us to recall just a minute what we know about God. God created the heavens and the earth with just one word. He flooded the earth but saved Noah and his family. He put the rainbow in the sky. God gave Abraham children at 100 years old. God brought the plagues on Egypt. He parted the Red Sea and he fed the people with manna. He halted the Jordan River. He brought down the walls of Jericho, which we're going to see next week. Praise God. If God tarries and Jesus doesn't come back, he can, you can if you want to, Lord. We're ready if you come. Gave Israel victory. Saved Israel from her enemies. He shut the mouths of lions. He made kings bow down. Lord Jesus was born of a virgin. He lived a sinless life. He healed the sick and raised the dead. He died on a Roman cross for you and me. And then by the power of God, he was raised again on the third day. And one day, he is coming, and every eye will see him, every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Our God is unequaled. There's no one like him. There's no one that has the power of our God. That's what the children of Israel learned as they crossed over the Jordan River. But secondly, our God is unavoidable. He's unequal, but he's also unavoidable. You can't run away from him. You can't get away from him. You can't hide from him. It doesn't matter where you go. God will find you. God sees you, and God knows. Now listen to what happens next. The Lord said to Joshua, "Today I will begin to exalt you in the sight of all Israel." Notice that it happens in the sight of all of Israel. Everybody sees what God is doing. And everybody knew what God was doing. They couldn't avoid the situation. They knew that there was this obstacle in front of them, but now they're about to watch the power of God come alive in their lives. He says, "Today I'll begin to exalt you in the sight of all Israel, that they may know that as I was with Moses, so I will be with you." And now in that day, before the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit hadn't come in power the way He's come in our lives, with a point where we always have the Lord Jesus with us wherever we go. That hadn't happened yet. But God can say to us today, just as I was with Moses, I'm with you today, if you know the Lord Jesus. He's come near. God had provided leadership through Moses. He had been in constant communication with Moses, and Moses became the mouthpiece of God for the people so that they knew the will of God. Now Joshua had taken his place. And just as God had parted the Red Sea under Moses, under Moses' leadership, he was about to part the Jordan under Joshua's leadership. And all the people were going to see. And God was calling the people to come and submit their lives to His word and His leadership in their lives. He says, "As for you, command the priests who bear the Ark of the Covenant. When you come to the brink of the waters of the Jordan, you shall stand still in the Jordan." And Joshua said to the people of Israel, "Come here and listen to the words of the Lord your God." I'm going to tell you this. God is still saying exactly the same thing to you and me today. He's saying, "Come here and listen to the words of your God." Now, many of us, we're running in the opposite direction of what God has to say. And listen, it's not a pandemic that keeps people out of church. It's not cold weather that keeps people out of church. It's not daylight savings time that keeps people out of church. It's the Word of God that keeps people out of church. Let me explain that to you. When you get under the authority of the Word of God, it changes you. And people don't like change. We want to hold on to what we've got, whether we make it or not. Doesn't really matter however the song goes. We want to hold on to it. And we want to hold on to our sin, and we want to hold on to our way of life and our way of thinking and our own control over our lives, our own personal authority over our lives. But whenever we come near and listen, it changes us. But I'm going to tell you this, whether you run or whether you come and you stay, that word that God spoke is still the authority over your life. You can't get away from it. You can't get away from what God says. Jesus said in John 12:48, "The one who rejects me and does not receive my words has a judge. The word that I have spoken will judge him on the last day." You can spend your whole life running, but on that last day, God's word will catch up to you. God is everywhere we go. People today rebel against the presence of God and the truth of who God is. Paul talks about it in Romans 1. What the people did back then is the same that they do today, and what they do today is the same as what they used to do back then. "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth." So we want to put God's word down. We want to bury it. We want to burn the book. We want to ban it from schools. We want to ban it from the libraries. We want to ban it from the public sphere. But you cannot get away from God. You can't get away from the truth. "For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so they are without excuse. You don't have an excuse. I don't have an excuse. God is like Legos in a house full of boys. They're just everywhere, and you constantly step on them. You run into them. God is like Dollar General stores. He just keeps popping up everywhere. And you're here today, and you're hearing God's word. Once again, you're being confronted by who He's called you to be, what He's declared over your life. Maybe it's time today to decide, I don't need to try to avoid God anymore because God is unavoidable. I need to come face to face with the reality of who God is today, and I need to surrender my heart to Him. David said it this way in Psalm 139. Where shall I go from your spirit, or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as day. The darkness is as light with you. I love the words of S.M. Lockridge, great evangelistic preacher. He said, I wish I could describe him to you. He's indescribable. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. I'm trying to tell you the heaven of heavens cannot contain him, let alone man explain him. You can't get him out of your mind. You can't get him off of your hands. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. The Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. The witnesses couldn't get their testimonies to agree, and Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. He is absolutely unavoidable. One day every knee will bow, but it won't bow to a flag, it won't bow to a president, it won't bow to a political party or an ideology, but it will bow to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Not only is he unequaled and unavoidable, I want to tell you thirdly, our God is unstoppable. He's unstoppable. Look, listen, the children of Israel, learn this. Look at verse 9 with me again. And Joshua said to the people of Israel, come hear and listen to the words of the Lord your God. And Joshua said, here is how you shall know that the living God is among you, and that he will without fail drive out from before you the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Hivites, the Perizzites, the Girgashites, and the Amorites, and the Jebusites. Behold, the ark of the covenant of the Lord of all the earth is passing over before you into the Jordan. Now therefore, take 12 men from the tribes of Israel, from each tribe a man. And when the soles of the feet of the priests bearing the ark of the Lord of all the earth, shall rest in the waters of the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan shall be cut off from flowing, and the waters coming down from above shall stand in one heap. Now that's a big deal. But God told them ahead of time what was about to happen. The Jordan was an immovable obstacle for the Israelites, but the perfect opportunity for God to display his unmatched and unlimited power. Our God is unstoppable. Now, as you think about the Jordan River for just a minute, it was overflowing its banks at that moment. Normally, the Jordan River is less than about 100 feet wide at the widest point. But that day, during this harvest season, the Jordan River could become 1,500 feet wide, 30 feet deep in some places, well over the normal depth of at most 10 feet. Now you imagine, that's a physical barrier. The Jordan River comes down from the Sea of Galilee about 60 miles. And during that short span, relatively short distance of 60 miles, it drops 610 feet in elevation. So the water during the harvest time comes down like a raging torrent. So it's a physical barrier. But can I tell you, there is absolutely no physical barrier that can stop our God. Amen. I just think about, I wonder if this is going to be the case for us whenever we are glorified in heaven. Jesus was able to just appear and disappear and go here and go there after his resurrection. I wonder, will we be able to do that too? Can we just, no physical barriers whatsoever. A physical barrier is no barrier to God. Time and space is no barrier for God. God is everywhere all the time. He's omnipresent. There is nothing that can stop our God. It was a physical barrier for the people of Israel that they needed to see moved, because God can do that. And that's what we learn about our God, is God can do anything. He can move anything out of your way. Jesus told us that if we believe in our heart that that mountain needs to move, and we pray to God, we believe that he can do it, the mountain will move. But not only was it a physical barrier, it was an emotional barrier. Because in this moment, the children of Israel knew that the last time their parents went into the land of Canaan, they got kicked out. And they've heard the stories of the giants that were in the land. And so no doubt they had emotional issues with this. 40 years of wilderness wanderings will wear down your heart. The promise of something better and greater on the other side of that river caused all of those emotions of their parents dying in the wilderness to rise up within them. For some of you, the reason that you have such a hard time fully trusting the Lord is because you've had hurt and pain in your life. But can I tell you that God's not the author of hurt and pain and difficulty? That's not who he is. The thief comes to steal and kill and destroy. But Jesus said, I have come that you may have life and have it abundantly. You bring that emotional burden and you lay it down before Jesus, and you watch the lifter of burdens lift that right up off of you today. If you'll just come and lay it down. Trust him. Not only was it a physical barrier and an emotional barrier, but it was also a spiritual barrier. There was a spiritual battle that was raging in the hearts of the children of Israel that day. Can God be trusted to deliver on his promises? Every Israelite that day learn to say right there in their hearts, as they saw the waters of that Jordan River dry up, they learned to say, there is nothing my God cannot do. There is nothing my God cannot do. And then verse 10, he is the living God and he's among us. I want to tell you today, God is the same yesterday and today and forever. He's still alive. He's still the God of miracles. There is nothing that can stop our God. And you are either on the train with God or you're on the track. It's one way or the other. You are either on God's train, the will of God, or you're on the track. And I'm going to tell you this. That freight train can't stop. I looked this up. The average freight train is about 1 to 1.25 miles in length. Can you imagine that? I've seen that. I've sat there waiting on that train to go by. 90 to 120 rail cars is about the average. When it's moving at 55 miles an hour, it can take more a mile or more to stop after the locomotive engineer applies the emergency brake, up to a mile. I was watching one of those railway safety videos, and the question in the video was, can a train stop? Or will it stop? And the answer is yes, it will stop. After it's driven your car for a mile down the track, it will stop, finally. Nothing can stop our God. If He says it, He will do it. It will happen one way or the other. His promises are true. And nothing can stop you from reaching God's intended plan for your life if you are going with God. I will tell you lastly, not only is He unequaled and unavoidable and unstoppable, but I want to tell you lastly, our God is upstream. And this ought to just warm your heart, every single one of us. Look at verse 14 with me. So when the people set out from their tents to pass over the Jordan, with the priest bearing the Ark of the Covenant before the people, and as soon as those bearing the Ark had come as far as the Jordan, and the feet of the priest bearing the Ark were dipped in the brink of the water, now the Jordan overflows its banks, the waters coming down from above stood and rose up in a heap very far away. Now, you can't recognize this just by reading the English, but Hebrew scholars tell us that the Hebrew language in this paragraph right here bunches up. It's almost like it's so hard to read it in Hebrew because it all just kind of bunches up. And it gives you this imagery of what's happening with the water. Because the city of Adam or Adam is about 16 miles to the north. And the Bible teaches us that the water stood up in a great heap that far upstream, 16 miles upstream from where the children of Israel were crossing at the town of Gilgal. So if you think about this for just a minute, in order for when the priests set their foot right in the Jordan River, in order for at that moment that river to dry up, it meant that God had to begin piling that heap of water up 16 miles away, hours in advance, maybe a day in advance, in order for that to happen at that very moment. God was upstream. He was already working, and He knew what was coming down the pipe. He knew what the children of Israel needed and the exact moment that they would need it. I wonder, does He know that about you? Can you say amen? Amen. God knows that about you and me. He knows exactly what we need and when we will need it. God looked down through the era of human history in which you would live. He knew exactly the place that you would be born, when you would be born there, the family to whom you would be born to. Not only that, He knew, He planned your eye color, your hair color, your personality, your physical makeup, all of those things. God wrote your DNA. God also knew the day that you would willfully sin against Him. The moment that you would say, God, I know that that's what I'm supposed to do, but I don't want to do it. And you would sin. And maybe you didn't say that word exactly that way. Maybe that's not exactly the way you put it. But God knew the day that you would rebel against Him. He knew that you were born into sin. And that you would become a sinner. He knew that you needed a Savior. And so God, in His time, in His perfect timing, and in His way, because He's upstream from you, He sent His one and only Son to live a perfect, sinless life, and then to die for you on a sinner's cross at just the right moment when you needed it. God sent His Son to die for you. And so He puts the offer on the table. He says, I've done all of this. God paraded that Ark of the Covenant in front of the people. He brought the Ark of the Covenant right into the middle of the Jordan. The waters of the Jordan were cut off and the people went through. It's a picture of our salvation that God brought His Son to this earth. He lived and He died for you and me so that we could go through into the promised land that He's given. And He's saying, do you trust me? That's really all it amounts to, is whether you're going to believe God or you're going to deny Him and you're going to walk away. The offer's on the table. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? As you consider that offer, if you've never trusted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, this is your one shot. This is the only thing you've got. You've got nothing else. There's no other options. The only option that you have to go forward with God is to trust Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You can deny Him and walk away. It's your decision. But He's calling you today. And He's saying, put your faith and your trust in me, and I will save you. If you're a Christian today and you know the Lord Jesus, He's saying the same thing that He told you on the day that you trusted Him. He's saying, trust me, and I'll lead you home. That's all you got to do. Just keep trusting me, and I'll lead you all the way. If you want to put your faith and your trust in Jesus for the very first time, I want to lead you in a prayer to do that. It's not a magical prayer. The prayer itself doesn't have power. The power is in what our God will do the moment that you mean it with all of your heart. And you confess your sin before Him, and you repent, and you turn to Him. So you pray this prayer with me, and I'll lead you in it. Say, dear Lord Jesus, I admit to you that I am a sinner. I've done things that I know are wrong, and I haven't done things that I know are right. And I deserve the penalty for my sin. But Jesus, I believe that you lived a perfect life. And that you died on the cross for me to pay the penalty for my sin. I know that you were raised on the third day. And that you're alive. So I turn to you now. I repent of my sin. I ask you to be my Lord and to be my Savior. Forgive me of my sin. Give me a home in heaven with you. I'll spend the rest of my life on this earth living for you and serving you. Thank you for my salvation. Thank you for the promise of your presence with me today. It's in your name I pray. Amen. Amen. Would you stand with me? If you prayed that prayer this morning and you meant that with all of your heart, we're going to give you an opportunity to share what the Lord Jesus has done. Let us know what Jesus did for you. It's been a marvelous and miraculous change in your life that's happened. Don't hold that in. Let the church know so we can celebrate with you and so that we can lead you in believers' baptism. If you've never been baptized before, why not obey the Lord in that command? You come. If you're looking for a church home, Myrtle Grove Baptist Church welcomes you, and we love you, and we want to help you serve the Lord Jesus in any way we can. If you're looking for a church home, you come today. God's put it on your heart that this is the place for you. If you need prayer, our prayer counselors are coming. Our altar counselors will be here. You can pray right there in your pew, whatever it is, during this time. This is your time to respond faithfully to what God has put on your heart to do. So let us sing together, and you come. 66 and verse 6. The psalmist is recounting all that God has done, and he says, He turned the sea into dry land. They passed through the river on foot. The response of the people, there did we rejoice in Him. Amen. The people worshiped our God because of all He had done. I mean, that's the response of a grateful people. If in your life, God has been upstream and we've seen Him be a God like no other God. We've seen Him move mountains in our lives. If you've seen that happen, what should that response be? You should rejoice in Him. Wherever you go, no matter where you are, people need to see you loving your Savior. That's what they need to see more than. They don't need to know everything that you know. They don't even need to know that much about you, except for you to be able to tell them, my God is a great God. My God is unstoppable. My God is upstream. And what he did for me, he can do for you.
Good morning, church. You may go ahead and have a seat. We're already halfway through March, but there's still plenty of opportunities to get involved with just various ministries here at Myrtle Grove, and we would love to see you guys just stepping out and getting involved in all that we do as we continue to just try to share the gospel in various ways to the community and to all those around us. We have a rummage sale coming up at the end of the month for the PLC, which is very exciting. I got to see some of the collection of some of those goods yesterday, and there's a lot of good stuff already in there, so I would love to see you guys join us for that. We're also beginning to collect and prepare already for Easter and all that we do during that time of year, as there is so many different opportunities during that season to reach out to those around us. And so we're beginning to collect candy and Easter eggs and all those items for when that comes around, because we put a lot into reaching the families in the area during that time. I always feel awkward, but I do also have to let you guys know about some opportunities to give towards just youth ministry. And it always feels weird coming up and asking for money, but the goal really is for the best interests of the students. And so every summer we take the students to a camp called Fuge Camps, and our children go to a camp called Camp Baldwin. And unfortunately, just in order to do those ministries, it does cost money. For, I don't know for the children's side how much it costs per student, but for the youth side, it comes out to about $365 per student to do this week of camp. But they are, I mean, lives are changed at this camp. This is where I got called to ministry, was at one of these Fuge camps. This is where some of our students got saved and decided to get baptized at some of these camps. But not all of them have the opportunity to be able to afford that. But you guys every year blow me away with how much you guys do for supporting the youth and giving them opportunities. And so we do various kinds of fundraisers. We have some coming at the end of the month with food and opportunities like that, like a bake sale and stuff like that. But then we also do some smaller ones that students, just with their scheduling and everything, I don't know if you know this, but they started spring break today. And so many are going to be visiting families and stuff like that. So we wanted to do some fundraisers that just have opportunities for the church to be able to give, where the students kind of help out. And so we do what's called an envelope challenge every year. And so I have on a table out there with a blanket I had in my car as a tablecloth, a bunch of envelopes. It was a nice blanket. It's one I got from camp, so I thought it was fitting. But I have envelopes numbered 1 through 50. And if you feel led to just help sponsor one of these students or give towards one of these students, if you want to grab one of those envelopes and just pray over it, and pray over the student that money might go help send to camp, you are welcome to take one and then put whatever you feel led to give towards. We have 18 spots this year going. That's 14 students and 4 adults. But even the adults, if you ask some of the adults who have gone, they get a lot out of the camp too. And they get encouraged to see the youth kind of give towards that. But we even have some on a waiting list, so we might even be adding more spots, which is exciting. But we have 18 spots, and so if you wanted to grab an envelope, and as you feel led to give and pray over the envelope, and then just put it back in the offering plate next week, they know if they see the envelope that goes towards youth camp. We'd love for that. And we will have other fundraisers where the students will step up and be doing different things. And so be looking forward to that. But I just want to thank you for every year just giving out of your heart and giving out of wanting to see these students, being able to worship and see these students get excited for the gospel. And so wanted to thank you guys for that. We do have another announcement, I'm being told at the moment.